All right, let's hear it, folks.
I guess Pixie got a question.
I've never really thought about Chapter 13 being related to Chapter 12, which is pathetic, but...
It's not pathetic, it's just, it's a problem with stars.
I kind of wrote it down backwards because this really captured my thoughts, right? Every person is to be subject to the governing authorities. So far as it depends on you, be at peace with all people.
Mm-hmm.
Don't be wise in your own estimation. Don't be haughty in mind, and bless those who persecute you. Like, going backward that way, it's so clear. Like, no wonder he wrote it in this order.
Right, right.
It's, yeah, convicting.
Absolutely. Yeah, I hated it. But I love God. So that's what we're striving for. Dave.
As you were preaching, my thoughts went to Britain.
Okay.
And being subjected to the authorities. First thing that happened when we went to Britain was my cousin, who is a police officer in London, brought me out to and said, we're going driving. And you know what it's like to submit to the authorities and drive on the wrong side of the road, around traffic circles the wrong way?
Right.
I mean, you know, it's like every instinct in you wants to turn right, and you've got to turn left.
Brother Dave, you're basically a Christian martyr. Well done.
The side of the road on in Great Britain, that is actually a rule.
Yes.
I'm not going to lie.
No, it's just a different...
In Britain.
Anyway, not about roads. a question that I'm sort of anticipating is, well, what about the COVID vaccine? Like, is that something that is being required of me to, or is it no longer, but has been required of me? Should I have gotten the jab? Your pastor has not been vaccinated, just for the record. I think it's fine if pastors have been. I just have not been. So I have not gone along with that mandate. I will say a couple of things. The first one is within our government, there were religious exemptions allowed. You could apply for those. You could go that route. And so I would have suggested anyone who wanted to avoid consequence, you can go that route. You are still walking within government guidelines for avoiding doing something that your conscience tells you not to. For those of you who have gotten the vaccine, I mean, fine, that's great, no issues with it. But for those who haven't, we generally have very strong reasons for not having gotten it. And the other thing I would say is there is an element of my body is a temple of the Lord. May it be that I have, I am given by God authority to decide what goes into my body. And so to resist the mandate in that way, I think is still grounded on a Christian principle. Just for the record, I bring that up not to preach that. Like, I'm not telling people don't get the vax, do get the vax. I'm just saying for those of you who decided not to based on your Christian conscience, I don't think you are disobeying the command of Romans 13. That's all.
An extension on that. So I feel like kind of the more base version of that question is like, where is the line of like the government can say like, this is what you're supposed to do, this is what you're not supposed to do, but where is the like, if the government says that all Christians must be killed, you know,
right.
Oh, that is not a good thing. I will not do that.
You will not go out and kill a Christian, right?
Yeah. But when you bring it down a step to like less killing and more just harm, like, where's that line? Or at least where's the vague idea of where that line is?
Again, I think the line is the government requiring you to do something which God has commanded you not to? Is the government requiring you to abstain from something which God has commanded you to do? And I would actually align that with like if suddenly the government came down and said Christians can no longer congregate in groups of more than three. Or more than five, like we're disobeying that command because it is against the word of scripture.
I guess what more I'm going along with is like, if the government says everyone must poke a hot stove once a day, where does that type of stuff go?
Okay. So it's not foolish, or sorry, it's not specifically called out as counter to the Christian conscience.
It's more like, this is bad. I know this is bad.
It's absurd.
It's like, this is wrong. This is hurting people.
We all had to wear stars like the Jews did.
Well, actually,
more like Okay.
Like you say, sorry, one second. Did you say poke a hot stove? Is that what you said?
I guess more of a more example, like the government says everyone can no longer have pinkies. They must be surgically removed.
And again, that comes back to that's literally shedding blood. Like that's meaningless corruption of a human body.
Okay.
That goes against the we are made in the image of God, the creation mandate there. Mm-hmm. I think the same would go for everyone has to poke a hot stove. The mm-hmm. weird one, this has never occurred.
Yeah.
But everyone must tap the refrigerator door 3 times before opening it, like something along those lines, where it's not harming anybody, but it's absurd. I didn't think about that some more. I'm not quite sure how.
Now that said,
has never occurred in our nation. It's I think stuff like that has occurred in something like North Korea, but I just don't have any context to answer that question.
Yeah, it's the reason I was kind of asking that is I know it's not happened before, but a lot of other reasons people have for not submitting to laws or think they shouldn't is based off of that. Like it's usually a little wishy-washy as to whether cutting people's pinkies off, that's wrong. Mm-hmm. That's obviously wrong. But where you get stuff like the vaccine, it's we don't know if it might cause harm. It gets more wishy-washy. That's more the base version of it, is what I was thinking.
Right. I think, and again, especially in America, and especially as far as what we, like I said, the exception is you don't have to shut up about it. I'd say if when laws come down that are simply foolish, mm-hmm. It's within the Christian conscience and responsibility to speak out against it. I think I heard Daniel first, then we'll come to you, Anthony. Or maybe actually, no, I saw Peggy's hand first. Peggy, then Daniel, then Anthony.
Well, Irwin lost his job at CMC because he refused to get the vaccine. They required it 100%.
Yep.
And he didn't even think the Christian exemption was appropriate for himself. He said it was just his personal feelings.
Sure.
So he was fired.
Okay. Yeah. And I think that what was the question? Was there a question or was this just recounting? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think along those lines, he per his Christian conscience, or per his conscience, he disobeyed the command and he accepted the consequence.
Right.
And that's sort of what it comes along with. And it's trusting in the Lord. I see your hand, Sam. Let's come to Daniel. Did I hear you piping up to say something? If not, that's fine. I thought I heard something.
No, I didn't say nothing.
Okay. Let's go to, I said Anthony next. Go ahead, Anthony.
I was thinking with Jonathan.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of the government law, maybe Jonathan's leaning toward the private business law and rules.
Oh, so, okay. So that's true. What does governing authorities apply as well to your job kind of thing? To that, I would say, yes, that is an organization of people who are searching toward the common goal. And I know several people who said, I'm not getting the vaccine, just as an example, that is a hot cultural moment, the vaccine thing, and they lost their jobs for it. I know you were threatened to lose your job for it at one point or another. And it's one of those things I recall in talking with you, the mentality you had was, okay, I'm not going to do it. You can fire me. Fine. And I think that is the mentality there. If the governing authority calls you to do something that's against the Christian conscience, then yeah, if you don't do it and you get fired, there's separate consequences for it. That again is trusting in the Lord. Okay, I have honored the Lord in my action. I trust that he's going to get me through whatever hardship this is going to cause. Sorry, Sam, then Alan, and Cheryl.
So basically, to relate to this whole vaccine thing, I'm not sure if I did the right thing when I took the vaccine because, you see, I only got it so that I can, get the government off my back on going outside without a mask.
So I'm going to go ahead and say again, if you have gotten the vaccine, I still don't see it as a moral culpability that anyone got the vaccine. Okay. If you got the vaccine, fine, great, that's fine, you're good. if there are consequences for having gotten it down the line, if there are consequences for having not gotten it down the line, we live with those. But you acted on the information that you had. You decided, I'm going to get the vaccine. You got the vaccine. That's fine.
Yeah, and I think what I'm trying to doubt is my mentality at that time because, all I wanted to do was to get people, the government off my back so I can finally not wear a mask and be free and all that.
Sure. And I think that's a conversation you and I can have more privately. I mean, that's more like, where's my heart at when I do something kind of issue. And I think it's a reasonable question to ask. We can talk about that more, just you and me.
Okay.
Alan.
The big question on a lot of these things is, you get a mandate from the government and it goes against other laws that are in place in the government.
So where there's contradiction within the system itself.
So you
itself.
Have a contradiction.
Right.
Well, which one of these do I follow? The government says we can't be coerced to have this shot.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're mandating we have the shot. So the solution is, okay, if you feel that part of the government is wrong, you disobey it, civil disobedience,
I think,
and you deal with the consequences until that gets through the legislative process, the mandates, you sue the government. And basically that's what, or you petition the legislature mm-hmm. to change this. And
right.
that's what's happening now. A lot of, they're walking back that some of these mandates were wrong.
Well, and like, and again, suing the government, that is a completely legal process that is within
right.
that is within the law of the land that you're allowed to do that. So yeah, I'm not going to say, to somebody, don't ever sue the government. I would say, are you suing them? Why are you suing them
right.
as a Christian? Are you suing it because it's inconvenient? Or are you suing them because they are calling you to do something that, like, calling you to act in a way that is unchristian?
And not only act in a way, that something that there are other laws that say you deserve, like our tax exemption.
So
we were authorized.
I'm going to talk one second here. So sorry, I apologize. I think, yes, there are instances where laws are misapplied, like, especially we're talking in the American system. And that's really what we're talking about here, where a law is misapplied or a law is contradictory to another law. Like, that is just the city. It is honestly the citizen's responsibility to pursue clarity on such
right.
things. And so, like, when we got our taxes back, that we had to pay initially because we are tax exempt as a church. We got those back, but we didn't do anything wrong there. We were ensuring that the law was actually applied appropriately. That's what we were doing. We weren't rebelling against the law. We were clarifying and seeking to uphold the law that existed. Yeah. Cheryl.
I was just wondering if you could talk a little more. You said that we're not required to remain silent. But then we also have, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all people
mm-hmm.
and don't be wise in your own estimation. Like, I'm trying to figure out how that all ties together. Cause I feel like I could easily take the exception as my rule.
Yes, oh, absolutely. That's why I say that they are exceptions. So, okay. Again, I will say when I say, this is not a call to remain silent, but rather to speak out. What are you envisioning when you hear the phrase speak out?
Honestly, sadly, mm-hmm. it's Facebook grumbling and a lot of yelling people on YouTube.
Right, exactly. That's what we envision when I say speak out. And thank you for the clarification. That is not what I mean. The other principles of communicating with a population that has fallen still apply, like speak the truth in love. If I just get on Facebook to be antagonistic about something, that's not, what is that accomplishing? That's just showing, hey, I have a political opinion. Be aware that I'm intelligent and I'm strongly principled. As opposed to allowing the gospel to go forth. So yeah, I think the communicative principles still apply as far as speaking out. Like our goal is to, yes, hold government accountable, but maybe not do so with just belligerent vitriol. Maybe do so with truth and love.
So what about just amongst ourselves saying, that's not right, that's not right, that's not right. Like, at what point does it go from we're talking about it and complaining to we're talking about it and like if this is a good thing, right? Because in order to organize a rebellion against something horrible, you'd have to talk about it.
Mm-hmm. And again, I think that comes back to the hearts of the people doing so. If I'm engaging in a conversation about a political thing, mm-hmm. again, let's take abortion as an issue.
Right.
If I'm engaging with a conversation within the church about abortion, where is my heart at when I'm doing that, when I'm having the conversation? Is my heart in a place of like hating those who are preaching the abortion gospel? Or is it from a place of wanting everyone to know just how angry I am and how holy I am for being as angry as I am? Is it from a place of just wanting to complain, just wanting to vent and actually not seek any solution, just to have everyone know that I'm angry about this thing? Or is it from a place of actually trying to organize and see an evil done away with in our society? That comes down to a hard situation. We should have conversations around how to approach and abolish abortion. We should do that. We should acknowledge that it is evil. We should not mince words that killing children in the womb is a wickedness. But where is your individual, where is your personal heart at while you're having those conversations? That's what I think that's what this command really speaks to.
Yeah.
We should hold government accountable to that sort of thing. But the question is, how do you go about doing it? And then when those conversations come around, maybe speak plainly, calmly, lovingly, and not get baited into lots of yelling. Because like I said, the enemy wants nothing more than to spoil the witness of the church by turning us into belligerents and malcontents in the eyes of the public. So when they yell at us, so to speak, when the enemies of God yell at us, don't yell back. Don't repay evil for evil. Speak strongly, speak firmly, stand on truth. But there is a way of doing it that is in love and one that is just in emotion and in anger and in rage. I don't know if that helps.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think you're right. When I say speak out against government, what we think is that people, the people in the streets with faces painted on megaphones, just chanting random political slogans. That's probably not what we're talking about. Furthermore, yes, address the government. People will hear, people will see. But also even more than that, the stronger encouragement to the Christian is go out and win souls for Christ. Like, find individual people and bring them to Jesus.
Address to government. Biden, what about the balloon?
Sam, why?
What?
Why?
Sorry.
The whole point of this is we're not... I do mean to call you out because I think that was actually an incorrect thing to say. We're trying to honor the government as best we can. We pray for those who persecute us. We pray for those who are in leadership. Let us not jump to mockery whenever it suits us. And again, Sam,
yes, something got the best of me.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
That was tough.
Look, yes. Sam, I've done exactly what you just did.
Yeah.
I have. We all have.
We get frustrated.
You just happened to do it in this moment, and so it became a teaching point, and I apologize for that.
Reminds me of one of my favorite quotes. If you look back on your past and cringe, that's a good thing. It means you've improved.
Yeah.
If you look back at your past and you don't cringe, that's a problem because there's a lot of ways that you fail.
Yeah, I cringe a lot. Thank you, Johnny. That's well put. That might make it into the sermon someday. Other thoughts, other questions?
Come back to what Johnny said about frivolous laws.
Yeah, absurd.
Other governments like North Korea. And there's a death in the boil or the dictator's family, everyone is required to cry.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or everyone's required to applaud when they don't agree with it. That's not going against Christ, right? But it's
I think it is. I think it is a mandate on you to affirm something that you might not want to affirm. Like if the mandate is Kim Jong-un gets up and says, I am your God, and you are required to clap. Like you don't want to affirm that Kim Jong-un is a god, and that requirement does apply specifically to you, to your action. I recognize that this is one of those things that is easier said than done from my cushy American context. I think the Bible would encourage the believers of the North Koreans to abstain from those actions. They'll probably be killed. That's what it comes down to. I'm just speaking what the word has to say. I recognize that I don't have a context to fully grasp the gravity of what I just said, but I think that is what scripture would have us do. And I think that's the example set by Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, by Daniel, by Joseph, by Jesus, so on. I think it's easy to look out at the world and see oppressive governments that are just really terrible. North Korea is sort of the punching bag, or maybe Vladimir Putin in our minds. to some extent, brothers and sisters, and I mean this with all the love in my heart, that they're not actually our problem in some sense. Like, we pray for them, we pray, and if the person is so moved to go serve the people in those areas, do so, to go minister to those people in those areas, do so, bring the gospel. But that is not a call. There's no call on the Christian to have an uprising against a foreign government for wickedness that they're doing. No. Sam.
If, speaking of that, when like, if I think it's harder to follow Christ and disobey what the government is doing if you being killed is a very slow and painful death. I think it's a lot easier if you know you're just gonna be out really quick. Because think about it, if you get a slow and painful death, you would have a lot more fear because you would be owing so much.
I think what you're pointing out is to follow this command requires a great amount of bravery.
Yes.
Yeah.
In some instances, and I think you're correct. And that bravery can only come not from my own strength, but from trusting in the Lord.
Yeah.
If I am to die, slow or quick, I'm seeing Jesus in a few minutes, whatever or however long that period may be of suffering before death.
Yeah.
I heard a cough. Daniel, I keep coming over here just because I hear noise, just in case you have some thought.
Nope, ain't okay. Late.
Cool. That's not a requirement for you to have a thought, Daniel. I keep hearing something from over here and I want to make sure I'm not missing you. That's all. Okay, final thing, Alan Godek, and then we're done.
Okay. I think this is a big one. The transgender.
Yes.
The whole thing about taking children and putting them through
yes.
the process to become transgender.
It's a terrible societal evil.
When they yeah. can't make it a decision on it or we wouldn't allow them to make a decision on anything else.
Right.
And yet there's no protection for these children. And yet our government said we cannot discriminate against transgenders.
Yes. So what's your point?
The point is, I don't think the Christian church as a whole is sending a message at this point. And I think we need to, not that they should be persecuted, those who have done this, but certainly we should be talking about not allowing the mutilation of children.
I think we do. I think individuals do or try to. I think that the greater application of this, honestly, is when we as Christians come across those who are struggling with a transgendered identity, as they might call it, to minister and to bring the gospel. The reality is, and this is really what it comes down to, because the question I was going to ask is, okay, what message are we sending? Is it a message of anger and rage, hey, you can't do this, you can't do this? Or is it a message of, look, because the truth, the Christian position on this is that it is actually harmful to anyone, let alone children, to mutilate their God-given bodies to match an emotional feeling. The hope is actually, the hope in scripture and in truth is that what you're going through emotionally, if someone is dealing with transgender identity or what do you call it? Gender dysphoria,
yeah.
Is that God made you as he intended to make you and you are not a mistake. Like that's the hope. And so that's the message that we send, I think, to individuals as well as to the government. And again, I think that falls under speaking out against an evil. It's the same category as like abortion. Maybe do so with love and truth. Maybe not just do so loudly to make sure that people know that we're loud about it.
Right.
Right.
The hard part is we have the feeling when you hit 21, you have freedom to do what you want.
There is intricacies and strangeness of laws that I think actually, yes, those are all discussions that should be had. Like, hey, let us try to form laws that protect children. And we see that happening all across the nation. And of course, they don't be voted on. Now, here's the fun part, actually. That's not fun. It's actually really the horrible part. We'll end here, which is those, as an example, those sorts of laws have popped up. We see this with like heartbeat bills about surrounding abortion. When Roe was struck down, there were a whole bunch of laws that were legislation that was pitched forward by conservatives and Christians entities to vote on by the populace to adopt in the Constitution to protect the unborn. Almost all of them were shot down, not by the government, but by the voting populace.
Right.
And so when we this is the part. How could God institute wicked rulers? Like, why would he institute a wicked ruler? Brothers and sisters, in judgment. If God wants to judge a people, he sends them a wicked ruler. Period. Like that's one of the things, that's one of the ways he dispenses judgment. Mm-hmm. And so you look at the United States, for example, the government is only reflecting the wickedness of the hearts that we see in Romans chapter 1 of the populace. Spread the gospel is the solution to this. Anyway.
Daniel?
I have something to say, actually.
Go ahead, Becky.
So, here's my thinking. The church is always behind the times. We don't know how to respond to things in our culture that are going on. And having worked with and having have several friends that are either gay, lesbian, or transgender, or both, they don't even know where they fit. And most Christians shun them.
Right.
And that's not falling in the love them the way that God loves them category. And yeah, there are all these rules and all these things that the government are trying to enforce regarding them, but they're not going to come to Christ if we're treating them like everybody else does. And we're really behind. I say this because my church, we had a man who did do the surgery, full grown man, not a child. And as a church, we had to, you know, my parents and the other leaders sat down and were like, okay, how do we handle this? And their response was, please come to church. Please know that we still love you. Just understand that you cannot have any leadership role in the church and you cannot work with children.
Right. I actually, like, I think that's the absolute correct response.
Yeah.
And again, we come back to the question of who requires the physician, the whole person or the sick? If we talked about this, my church is not my own. If we have a minimum requirement for worship with us, then we're not the church.
I think that they're often shunned because people fear that it'll come across as that they approve of it.
Yes.
I'm not saying that's right.
Right.
I'm not saying.
And I think actually the situation it sounds like here, these people, I'll use that as an example. I think it's a very upright way of handling something like that.
Yeah.
Yes, come, we love you. We will still support you. We will still, you know, we will still love you. We will still serve you. But because of your decision, like a total non-affirmation of the decision, you can't work with children. You can't have any leadership role.
Wait, so, then how can surgery make you not work with children?
I can explain afterwards. I don't want to get into just the whole big discussion. I think something like that, like a handling situation like that, acknowledging formally, just out front, we love you, we're going to continue loving you, but we can't have you do these things because we can't affirm this.
Chances are they wouldn't continue coming.
And that's their decision.
Right.
Honestly, that's, I mean, insofar as it depends on you, be at peace with all people, insofar as it depends on you, if it's possible. So in situations where somebody walks away, I think it's incumbent upon the Christian to reflect and say, like, okay, did I act in love? Did I act in truth? If yes to both, then you have fulfilled your responsibility. If there's any part in there where you're like, I did this wrong, seek to make reparations.
I've heard it said, I forget the exact words, but if you don't show love, you'll never win them over. But
people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. is a phrase that goes along those lines. Yeah.
Sometimes it's hard to show love without giving the impression that you approve of their lifestyle. So that's where it's.
I think that's a whole other discussion, which we can talk about another day.
Yeah.
But I agree, it is hard, and finding that line can be difficult. But that is another day. Let's pray. We've gone long. Mm-hmm. Heavenly Father, help us to trust in you. As we talked about this morning, we're going to get into areas, especially in the next chapters of Romans, where there seems to be gray. There seems to be a great amount of discernment that you require of your servants, Lord. Let us trust in you to find that discernment, to find what loving our neighbor really looks like. If our neighbor is the government official next door, if our neighbor is the gay person down the street, if our neighbor is our political enemy, our neighbor is our loved one. Lord, how do we love? Continue to reveal yourself in your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.